we get, for V1, we get 16.7 milliliters.
Liters.
Now, you could technically change it to liters, but you don't have to. And the reason you don't have to, y'all, look, is because these units are the same, right? Which means in terms of solving for this, your molars are gonna cancel and milliliters is all you'd be left with anyways. So you don't have to change it to liters. If you want to, you can. The only reason why, well, why do you think it might make more sense to leave it in milliliters?
Because
that's
what you started out with.
Okay, so because the original problem says milliliters,
that's what
absolutely.
You ended up with.
And because what?
That's what V2 is.
Because that's what because V2 is in milliliters. And also because, just thinking in chemistry one, did you ever do any sort of measurements where you actually measured things in liters, or were you always measuring in milliliters? Milliliters, right? All your graduated cylinders, your beakers, your flasks, they're all in milliliters. Pipettes, they're all in milliliters. So it would be a whole lot easier to measure it in milliliters than it would be to measure it into liters, okay? So that would be why. If you had changed it into liters, it's fine. It just would make it a little bit harder. You'd have to probably want to, or you'd probably want to change it back when you were all done. Because if you were actually trying to make it, it'd be really hard to make it if it was in liters. All right, so now how do we describe how we would make this? So now remember that we're taking this and we're making this. So that's really all we have to say. So if we're gonna describe this, how we would make it, we're taking our M1 and our V1 and we're making our M2 and our V2, right? So we could say something like this. Let's write it over here. Well, what was our M1 and our V1? Well, our V1 was 16.7 milliliters, right? So we're taking 16.7 milliliters of what? 4.5 molar. So we're taking our V1 of our M1. What?
Daddy's calling.
Okay, you can answer it. To make. Well, what are we making? We're making our M2 and our V2. So we're making what? We're making 250 milliliters of 0.3 molar solution.
So you don't have to add the enough water part, or no?
Oh. Yeah, I should have said water. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Of that and water. There we go. Now that's not the only way you could have said it. You could also say it so that it sounds more sophisticated, right? You could say something like, we're preparing this solution by, you know, starting with this and making this. I mean, there's all kinds of ways that you could go about describing exactly what you're trying to say. Bobby, what you need, buddy? Okay.
Thank you, Ms. Connor.
You're welcome, sweetheart. But that's it, y'all. That's simply what you would do. Take that and make that. All right, any questions about station 6 or any of those? No? All right, y'all, there's going to be problems exactly like that on the test, all right? Because ultimately, moving forward, you're going to have to be able to do those things because you're going to go into the lab and you're going to do that, all right? You're going to be told that you need this solution, and the question is going to be, how do you do it, all right? And you're going to be required to do it. So please, please make sure you're able to follow those steps or do those sorts of calculations and then actually do it in the lab, because that's a big skill to have. In terms of, you know, chemistry in college, the fact that you would be able to make your own solutions, you'd be far ahead the other students in your chemistry classes, all right? All right, questions? Yes, ma'am.
What day is the class?
Probably Thursday, I think, tentatively scheduled. Tomorrow, Y'all are going to do another challenge problem, which is what we're going to do next, is the challenge problem. Hey, I feel like I'm here all the time.
I've been coming here around.
I know. It's almost like I'm back. Just
come on back.
If I could, I would. But seriously, I'm almost here. 3.5 more weeks, and I'll be here. Yeah. Then they're going to wish I was gone.
I really do.
Once I'm back, they're going to
be complaining. It's going to be a win.
In comparison.
Can you go over station 4, like the fifth one that asked about like the oxidation reduction? I think I got the first one.
I made an eye and that's a frog.
Yeah,
I
think a frog.
Yes. Are you talking about question number 4 on station 4?
I think it's 5. It's just the very last one.
Where it says write the half reactions.
Yes, ma'am.
And label which is oxidized and which is reduced.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. And then, did anybody get to station 5?
I think I got to one of the 5s because there were 2.
I got to 8 and then I lost it.
Where's station 5?
Well, there's one that was the, you had to use the half reaction to solve it.
Okay, look, so I'm going to be honest with you. Station 5 is not going to be on a test. Like, there's not going to be a question like the station 5 challenge problem. I debated doing an extra credit, but I'm not even going to do that just because I wanted to make sure you had enough time. But the station 5, that was the big old long problem about the calcium carbonate. It's actually not, I mean, it's not as complicated as it seems if you just work through the information. But it's kind of challenging looking. It's kind of intimidating. And I know that, and that's okay. But did anybody attempt it?
I did A, but I didn't know what the titration was. I didn't know what that was.
The word titrated?
Yeah, I don't know.
All that means, okay, all right, we'll come back to this.
Okay.
All right, let's do this real quick. Let's talk about, you said question, the last question on station 4. Mm-hmm. All right, did anybody get the last question on station 4? I'm just curious.
I got you.
Did you guys go over the answers today?
Subtly.
She tried, but then she tried to write them on the board, and it
really did not
work.
Yeah.
Yeah.
She wrote lowercase letters like half of
this time. And her subscripts were her chemistry letters.
Yeah, her subscripts were her superscripts.
Yeah.
Okay.
Her subscripts were superscripts.
Tanya, everybody should get Mr. Evans' thing, where it's just like a T-shirt, a rag, but nicer. I suppose he's a T-shirt.
He's a rag.
Well, it's because of. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
All right, so I think this one's easier. So let's look at this one first. Oh, but y'all, you know these take a while to do. I'm assuming. So let's just move right on through. So let's start with, if we're, you know, this doesn't actually ask you to balance, right? So technically you're not even being asked to balance the equation. The only thing it's asking you to do is to write the half reactions for it, right? Now remember, all that really means is to separate it into the oxidation half and the reduction half. So let's look at this equation and see if we can figure out what's being oxidized and what's being reduced. Now remember, even what we talked about last Thursday, the very first thing we really should do is what?
Oxidation
states. Oxidation states, absolutely. So we want to find the oxidation states. What are their states as they sit in this reaction? So let's just start over here. What is sulfur on the reactant side oxidation state?
-2,
right? It's an ion, so it's just simply its charge. How do we know it's -2?
It has a negative charge.
Because of that. Because it's all this there, and it's got that charge, which means it's got to be -2. All right, what about the NO3? So tell me about that. Now, we don't necessarily know N, because remember we said N can change. But oxygen does not. Oxygen's charge is always what?
-2.
-2, there's 3 of them, so that's -6. So tell me about nitrogen.
Plus 5.
It is plus 5. That's exactly why. Good question, right? So why is it plus 5? Because that ion has a what? A net charge of negative 1. Now you go back to your solubility, or not your solubility rules, your oxidation state rules, and some of your rules said things like, you know, free elements are 0. And then it said that ions are their charge, right? And then it said that the sum of the charge on a compound is 0, but an ion is what it is, right? So if it's a compound, it might be 0. But if it's like a polyatomic ion, well, it's not gonna be, right? Like NO3 negative 1 nitrate, it's not 0 because its net charge is what? It's minus 1. Or if it was like SO4 negative 2, well, you would tell me that sulfate's charge is what? Minus 2. That negative 2 comes from whatever's inside of it, right? So as you're looking at this, nitrogen is plus 5, because why? Because you have a net negative 1 charge. If that negative 1 charge was gone, well, then they could equal, right? But it's there. Why? Because you have that net charge coming from the oxygen. Whatever it is you want, baby, you can have it within reason. You can play, you want to draw on the board, go ahead. Okay, all right, let's talk about the product side. Tell me about sulfur.
Zero.
It is 0. Why is it 0?
Because
it's a free element. Good. All right, what about nitrogen and oxygen? Oxygen, we always know, right? Minus 2.
Plus 2.
Exactly. That means it has to be plus 2. Now, why does it have to be plus 2?
Because
there's no charge, right? Because it's a compound. It's a neutral compound. No charge. So it's got to be plus 2. All right. So we don't necessarily still know what's being oxidized and reduced, but we do see our half reactions. And from this, we can figure out what's being oxidized and reduced. So let's go ahead and separate. We've got sulfur, which is minus 2, becoming what?